Thanks to the previous participants, he gave a very good introduction to my talk, because today I will show you our results on Cavity QED experiments with calcium in diamond. And the goal of our group is to use atom-like systems in diamond on cavities for many-body quantum optics and quantum networks experiments. And my talk, I will start my talk with a short introduction. We'll present a new approach for cavity QED based on nanophotonic devices and introduce you a silicon vacancy color sensor. It's a system which we use as a quantum emitter in our experiments. After that, I will proceed to cavity QED experiments which we performed with SIVs in diamond. After that, I will give you some information about many body physics which we can observe with SIV centers. In particular, I will show you SIVs and interactions mediated by the cavity, the mode of the optical cavity, which is the topic of this workshop. And at the very end, I will show you that we can make a long-lived quantum qubit, based on the SIV centers in diamond. Okay, let's start with the introduction. As we heard 5 minutes ago, goal of the cavity QED is to make a strong interaction between atom and photon. And to make its interaction stronger, you want to confine a photon to the small mode volume. And in this case, interaction strength is proportional to 1 over square root of the mode volume here. And photonic crystals is a very good source how you can confine a single photon to a mode volume about lambda cube. And then the only problem you have is just to integrate good quantum emitters with these photonic crystals. And it turns out this problem is not very easy. So, what emitter can you use to achieve a strong coupling between atom and cavity? The first solid-state emitter, which was strongly coupled to the cavity, was quantum dots. This approach has many advantages. For example, a strong atom-cavity interaction, and you don't need to trap or cool these quantum dots. But there are some drawbacks. For example, you have to position the quantum dots in the cavity mode, which is not straightforward. Then, due to local environments, these quantum dots usually have a very short coherence time and also huge inhomogeneous distribution of the atomic transitions. On the other side, we can use atoms trapped next to the nanophotonic devices. In this case, we benefit from long atomic coherence, small inhomogeneous distribution, and possibly large hyperactivity. But, as you already know, it's very difficult to trap and cool atoms next to touch devices. So, can we find a solid-state emitter which will combine benefits from both approaches and address these challenges? So, in the looking group, we investigate calcium in diamond to find such good solid-state quantum emitters. And color centers are point effects in diamond. It could be vacancies or impurities, or both of them. And probably the best known system is NVC center in diamond, energy vacancy center in diamond. In general, color centers have electronic levels in the host material band gap, like here, and feature atom-like optical and spin transitions. For example, for NV in a bulk diamond, atomic line is very stable with time and narrow. Unfortunately, this system, like NV, is very sensitive to spectral diffusion. It means that it's very sensitive to the fluctuation in the environment. So it's coupled to, for example, electrical noise. And this coupling to the environment causes huge diffusion. For example, here, when we do some experiment, we're just trying to make a resonance fluorescence experiment, but you don't see line anymore. So line just so broad, so you don't see it. And the reason for that is very simple. NV has a static dipole electromagnetic ground state. And this moment, dipole moment, couples linearly to local electric field noise. And this coupling is huge, which causes all this diffusion. And the solution is that we have to take different emitter. And in this talk, I will tell you about silicon vacancy tungsten diamond. SID is an interstitial detecting diamond. Silicon atom sits in between two vacancies in diamond lattice. And it's very important that this system has high symmetry. And particularly, it features inversion symmetry. Such symmetry prohibits SID from having static electrical dipole moment. And in this case, system coupled only quadratically to electrical noise. And this gives us protects us from the scattered diffusion in nanostructures, which you have seen before in NV, gives us stable lines, and somehow explains small inhomogeneous distribution of atomic transitions. And also, SIV is a bright single photon source, and it has optically controllable spin and orbital degrees of freedom. Let's look at the SIV level structure. Excited and ground states are coupled by strong coupling transition at 740 nanometers. Then, spin orbit coupling splits both levels into lower and upper branches, which results in four allowed transitions. Further, if you apply external magnetic field, each branch will split in two sublevels. But for the rest of the almost for the whole talk, I will use only these two transitions, C and D, in zero external magnetic field. Okay, we have finished with this introduction, and now we can proceed to real experiments which we've done with SID in cavities. To make our photonic crystals, we first fabricate one-dimensional suspended waveguide from bulk diamond, like boring. Then we define two break mirrors, like here and here, by making holes. And to integrate SIV center into the photonic crystal, we implant silicon ions exactly in the center of the cavity, which guarantees us that we hit the maximum the cavity field, electric field, to achieve the highest productivity we can. And in real life, like a device looks like this, like plane sections are waveguides. You see holes which are mirrors basically, and cavity somewhere in the middle. So our devices have quality factors of about 10,000, and mode volume slightly lower than the cube. And to increase electron efficiency of photons, we can couple tapered optical fiber to our devices. And this allows us to collect more than 80% of the photons from the fiber, from the cavity to the fiber. Okay, so we have a device, we have an atom in the crystal. Well, let's do some experiments. First of all, we probe the linear response of the system. We excite cavity with the laser, then monitor atomic fluorescence into the free space from the cavity, and collect transmitted light. So in the plot on the right, blue curve is the transmission, red is fluorescence from the free space. And a broad envelope here is the cavity resonance. It's very broad, it's about 50 meters. And all these additional features, like here, are SIVs, which are coupled to the cavity. And also you can see in the fluorescence that all these features have a peak in the fluorescence curve, which also supports that all this stuff come from the SIV, not from some additional defect in the system. And okay, let's zoom in on this region of the plot. Here we can see that two SIV, which are strongly coupled to the cavity, each atom can absorb, not absorb, extinguish the transmission light by almost 95%, almost 100%, pretty good. If we look in the fluorescence, when cavity is detuned, the alignment is about 300 MHz, and when cavity is on resonance with the atom, Purcell-Broadened line is more than 4 GHz. And this corresponds to a cooperativity of 11 between SIV and cavity. What I want to notice note here that we work in a pretty different regime from atomic QED. For example, our cavity is very broad, it's 50 GHz, but since that we have a very tiny mode value, our single photon radio frequency, G, is huge, it's 7 GHz. So we work like an impulsal regime with high cooperativity, which is a little bit strange. Anyway, and also, as I said before, we have multiple atoms which are coupled to the same cavity. Unfortunately, as you can also see, all these atoms have different frequencies. This is what you have when you deal with solid-state emitters. Okay, the picture I showed you, this huge extinction, is true when incoming light is very weak. Basically, it's true when you send to the atom, to the system just single photons. In this case, single photon will be reflected back almost perfectly, and transmission will be very weak. But the situation is very different when you send photon pairs. Basically, if you send one photon, this photon can virtually excite SIV, go from here to here. And when you send another photon with a delay which is much shorter than atomic lifetime, the second photon can stimulate emission of the first photon. And in this regime, two photons can go through the cavity. And it looks like that, atom coupled to the cavity can change the statistics of the incoming light. So if you send from the left to the cavity just a very weak laser light, basically coherent light, it has a vacuum component, it has single photon and photon pairs. And according to this picture, single photons should be reflected back and pairs should go through. So you change the balance between singles and doubles. And of course you can observe this if you measure G2 function in the transmitted light. And in this G2 function you expect bunching. So what we see? So basically it tells us if we detect one photon, and the probability to get another photon right away is much higher. So yes, we have pairs in the transmission. This shows that the system can be non-linear in number of photons, which might help to build single atom, single photon quantum gates. Okay, here I want to change gears. And until now, I describe experiments with a single atom in a single cavity. But next, I will tell you about many body physics in the SIV centers in time. Basically, when we have two SIVs in one nanophotonic structure. And I want to start with just waveguide, no cavity, only a one-dimensional waveguide, these two atoms inside. And using this setting, we were able to demonstrate entanglement between two atoms. To do that, we use the following protocol. Let's assume that we have two distinguishable atoms, distinguishable three-layer levels, here and there. And we drive them weakly with two lasers under these conditions. Then atoms can emit here. And after the detection of the first photon, system decays to the either EG or GE state. So basically after the detection of the first photon, we know which atom emits the photon, because atoms are distinguishable and photons have different frequencies. So we end up in the mixed state, boring. Okay, let's repeat the same, but then make atoms indistinguishable. So it means that they have the same transition frequencies. In this case, after the detection of the photon, we don't know which atom emitted this photon, because they are identical. And thus, the system ends up in the intended state, the B state, the bright state or the gradient state. So how can we prove that? How can we experimentally prove that we have this state in the experiment? To do that, we can do this in the by measuring again after correlation functions of the photons. And let's go back to the distinguishable case. This system, this state, mixed state, decays back with a probability gamma which equals to the decay rate of the single atom. And after the detection of the first photon, one atom is switched off. It's like in the ground state and can't emit anymore. So in G2 function, we expect to see G2 function to be 1/2 at zero delay because one atom is off. In this case, when atoms are indistinguishable, bright state decays back to the ground state twice faster than mixed state. And this enhanced decay brings up the G2 function to 1. So experimentally we observed these two curves, and it was like a signature of the entangled state. Okay, so this scheme is completely measurement based. So there is no real SIVFIV interaction. That's one point. And another point, it has a very low success rate because we drive our atoms very weakly and rely on the photon detection in one particular mode. And using Cavity QED, we can improve the scheme a lot. First of all, we can introduce SIVFIV interactions via Cavity mode, and we can make the scheme deterministic. Good. So let's do this. But before, I again want to stop a little bit and mention that all the time before, all the terms I showed you was done when Cavity was on resonance with the SIV. A resonance case, like here. In this situation, we have strong portal enhancement, and this can help us to overcome all defacing to make like a purely purely double transition, basically. And also we have, due to huge portal enhancement, very high bandwidth atomic transitions. As I said, it's maybe about 5 GHz wide. It's very fast in dynamics. But to make a SIV to interact with each other, we want to work in this first regime, when cavity is detuned from our atomic transition, like here. In this regime, SIV manifests itself as a peak in the transmission spectrum. And to give some ideas, some numbers, in the detuned regime, our effective radio frequency will be more than 300 MHz, which is still much higher than people achieve in atomic experiments. And experimentally, we can easily and precisely control atom cavity tuning, which allows us to go back and forth whenever we want. Okay. To build interaction between two SIVs, we start with two atoms, which are strongly coupled to the cavity in the dispersed regime. So we have two atoms, atom 1, atom 2. And interaction strength between two SIVs in this regime is J equal to G squared over delta, where delta is a cavity tuning from the atomic transition. In case when this coupling rate J is much less than atom-atom tuning delta, then we can treat two atoms independently because interaction rate is very, very small and we can neglect this. But if we tune two atoms on the resonance to each other, basically delta much smaller than coupling rate J, then SIV starts to efficiently interact with each other via cavity mode and form bright and dark states. Bright state is an entangled state, like as usual. It's coupled to the cavity and has shorter lifetime because coupling strength is higher. But also, this state decays to the cavity mode due to this coupling and can be visible in the transmission spectrum. In contrast, dark state, this one, is decoupled from the cavity. It has no proton enhancement and doesn't decay to the cavity mode. So it's dark in the transmission. And basically now we want to experimentally implement this scheme in our devices. So we start with again the two SRVs, which are strongly coupled to the cavity and it's tuned by two copper from the cavity resonances, so again the first regime. And we can tune atomic frequencies, basically change delta in the previous slide, by applying external magnetic field and make use of the Zeeman effect. So we initially have two atoms, which are 5 GHz apart from each other. In this case, and I didn't say that at such a tuning, our effective coupling rate, J, is about GHz. So in this case, 5 GHz is much larger than coupling rate, and atoms are independent. And independent atoms in our case have almost identical peak heights in the transmission spectrum. When you start to tune them close to each other, for example, here the tuning is about 2.4 GHz, interactions start to play a role in our dynamics, and atoms form like a bright and dark state, as I explained before. And since dark state isn't coupled to cavity as much as bright state, proton enhancement is smaller, effective convective capacitance is smaller, and its peak is also a little bit lower than the peak of the bright state. If you keep moving closer, the effect is more dramatic. When you're on resonances, dark state disappears, doesn't couple the cavity at all, because of the bright state. And if you keep moving further, like here, bright state repels from the dark state. So it's like a avoiding crossing. And this 2D plot does show that avoiding crossing much better than like this curve. So here we have a bright state, dark state. On the this axis we plot the detuning between atoms, delta. Here the detuning between atoms, delta, and here the detuning frequency of the bright and dark states. And our experimental data match theory plot pretty well, I would say. So thus we observe signature of the bright and dark states, and we also, in principle, can drive our system to this bright state with the lasers. So, it was the first demonstration of the interactions between two solid-state emitters which are mediated by optical cavity mode. And, of course, this data is preliminary. It was taken just basically last week, and we definitely need much more measurements to convince everyone and ourselves that it's true. But anyway, I think it's a pretty nice result. Okay. So here, I will stop discussing all cavity QED experiments, and we'll show you that we have one more piece which needed for quantum information and quantum whatever stuff. Basically, we can make a long-lived qubit based on the state centers. So let's go back a little bit to level structure of the studies. As I said, we have a lower and upper branch in ground state, which are coupled to the upper branch with a few transitions to the upper state. But unfortunately, SIV is very sensitive to acoustical phonons. Actually, phonons pretty well can mix these two levels pretty well. And this mixing limits the coherence time to about 200 nanoseconds at 4 Kelvin temperature. And of course, the most straightforward way how we can deal with this problem is cool down sample further. For example, at 100 kilokelvin temperature, there will be no phonons at this frequency. The phonon mode will be empty. It means that there will be no absorption of the phonons from here to here. And in this case, this level will be long-lived. To prove this, we measured absorption, optical absorption from these two levels at 4 Kelvin first, this dashed curve, and observed that absorption from these and these levels are pretty comparable for Kelvin. It means that thermal populations are always equal here and here, and this translates itself in the pretty high phono mixing. In contrast, at 100 kelvin temperatures, red curve, absorption from the level is zero. It means that population here is again zero, and we have no stimulated absorption of the phonons. Thus, this level is indeed long-lived and can be and spin sublevels in the magnetic field can be used as a stable qubit. And of course, to reach 100 kelvin temperature is not a very simple task. To do this, we use a dilution refrigerator. But since we want to do optical excitation collections, this fridge has very special optical access, which is not common in this community. And also, we have two optical access. We put high-energy objective to the mixing chamber of the fridge. So the system can go down to 20 kelvin temperature with a pre-placed optical access. And we also have a vector magnet, which allows us to apply magnetic field up to 1 tesla in any direction, which is very useful. Okay. So we have, in magnetic field, we have two spin levels in ground state and two spin levels in upper state. It's enough for all things we will discuss later. And these four levels are coupled by four optical transitions, and which are optically resolved. Then, branching ratio of the spin transitions depend on the magnetic field alignment. And the reason for that is the following: spin orbit interaction in the ground state sets the quantization axis for the spin. And when you apply magnetic field along the axis, you have one situation. When you are orthogonal, you start to compete with spin orbit coupling. It is why branch pressure depends on the alignment of the field. And by changing the angle between magnetic field and SIV axis, we can tune this branching ratio and basically tune the thickness of the optical transition. And this frequency sets the optical pumping rate. And this rate we can change from 100 nanoseconds in completely orthogonal field to more than 10 milliseconds when field is aligned along the axis. First of all, effective optical pumping allows us to initialize spin in the well-defined state, up or down. But also when the pumping is long, we can collect many photons before spin flips. And this helps us to realize single-shot spin set readout in aligned magnetic field. And fidelity here was about 80%, which can be improved further. So, okay, we have a qubit. We can prepare qubit in the state up or state down, whatever you want. So now we have to continue to control the qubit. To do that, we apply a microwave pulse resonant to the transition between spin up and down, and use optical transitions to read out the state. Doing this, we can coherently control the spin. For example, here you can see like a coherent radio oscillations, which are pretty long, it's about 4 microseconds. Unfortunately, when you have a solid state emitter, this emitter is usually coupled to environment, and slow environment fluctuations limit your coherence time, which you can achieve. But since we have a good coherent control, we can implement many microwave spin echo pulses to decouple our qubit from the environment. And this helps us to increase coherence of the qubit up to 30 milliseconds. And just remind you that at 4 Kelvin coherence was 200 nanoseconds. That's a huge improvement just by cooling down the system and doing simple connected sequences. But also, this time is so long because it's enough, for example, to send photon from one qubit to another qubit, which are separated by 1,000 kilometers, and still maintaining some quantum memory. Pretty long distance. And one more piece of information here, that since our coherence time increases linearly with the number of pulses, it means that there is still room for further improvements. So we definitely can go for longer coherence times. Okay, and to summarize the main results of my talk, we have efficient coupling to optical funnels while putting SIVs in the nanocavities. We demonstrated single photon nonlinearities in the SIV coupled to nanocavity. Also, we realized atom-atom interactions via the optical cavity mode, and also achieved long-lived quantum memories. So overall, we have homogeneous solid-state emitters with long coherence and strong coupling to photons. What can we do further with the system? For example, we can try to increase our cooperativity to achieve higher gate fidelity in the future, or try to make quantum emitters, or make a two photon gates using interactions between the SIVs and cavity. Or, for example, to generate two-dimensional photonic cluster states using our SIV cavity system. So it's pretty promising and exciting area for us now. Yeah, thank you for attention, and don't forget to see our poster by me here tonight. Thank you.
We have some questions.
Your observation of the dark state, you're seeing the dark state because your emitters are not exactly the same, right? Because if I have two identical emitters in the same resonance frequency, in a cavity I should not see any signature of dark state.
Yes, it's correct. So if I go back. Sorry, here. So when the emitters have different frequencies, like here, there's no dark state, no bright state. They don't interact. When you go closer, diffused by about 1 GHz, it's still not perfect dark state. But there's some mix between dark and bright state. But bright state is weaker and narrower. So in this region, there is no diffusion. You expect to see no dark state. We don't say anything, but it's difficult to prove. But there was like some hint that there is a real bright dark state. When we make a diffusion negative, like here, bright state is still on the right. It's not like a symmetry in our atomic conditions. It's really some interaction in them.
Cool. We have other questions.
If you want to prove that those two vacancy centers are entangled,
mm-hmm.
So like, say if I don't believe it, that's they're in a dark state, what would you do?
They're in a bright state. I mean, in principle, you can then visit another laser process, transfer atomic population to another state, and probe the states. If the system was in a bright state, you have one outcome. If the system was like in just a bare atomic state, there will be a couple differently, and you have different spectrum. That's exactly what we'll do further.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Another point, you can measure lifetime. So, bright state coupled stronger with the cavity. Mm-hmm. It means that it has a stronger photon enhancement, and lifetime is shorter. So basically, if you measure lifetime here and here, you should see difference.
Mm-hmm. I think I could do that with class without them being entangled by just putting a phase shift on one of the atoms, and I could enhance or decrease their emission into the cavity without entangling.
Yeah, I mean, I'll comment on that. On the part of my talk that I skipped, essentially we see exactly a version of this in the mean field limit with collective spins. Mm-hmm. It's a version of it. So it's really just the fact that you're seeing it with two single emitters that makes you feel like it must be probably in an entangled state.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. To add on to that, for instance, in this regime you have photon blockade still. It's still nonlinear. Mm-hmm. You could probe photon statistics and it's going to have photon blockade.
Okay. Any final questions? Last minute thoughts? Okay, let's thank Denis one more time. So I'll just remind everybody that spreadsheet, a lot of you have not done your homework. So I'm issuing grades tonight, and so if you don't get to it without having done your homework, you know the consequences.
And you're going to tell us about poster sessions?
Poster sessions are happening next.
And where about that?
Somewhere, where the reception is also. Paul will say that. You probably hear
that.
Can
I borrow it?
Notice how lack of knowledge never has presented because speaking.
What the one of the yellow
is.
There was also
another
really
like
you
senator wants to run for a 6 months.
Yeah.
Give it up.
I missed the first one.
So they're killing out.
We should.
I'm not allowed to have a federal patent.
Yeah.
You're going within the fear of it.
Yeah. Right. I mean, that's why there are terms of it somewhere.
I think this is all, I mean, it works quite nicely, yeah, so I'm